Okay, we're going to finish up the Sermon on the Mount. Let's open to Matthew chapter 5. And this is going to be a lot of note-taking. So flex your hands, get things ready. Okay, we don't get writer's cramp today. And just write a bunch of things on, because I have to zoom through the notes. And so I'm going to try to give you essentially what you'll need, plus a little bit more. We've looked at the contextual setting, and we've looked at what it means to the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God. You should be able to distinguish between those two things, see how they're related, or understand how they're related and how they're different, and how that understanding the kingdom of heaven in the book of Matthew, that we're in the postponement period, as it were, and this is where the church comes in. Okay, so it was always God's intention from the very beginning to give his the opportunity to the Gentile people, so it was nothing new to God, okay, that this was going to happen. So he established and foreordained the plan of salvation. He knew Adam was going to sin. He knew all of those sorts of things, and he and his love for us established us a way to have the blessings that he desperately wanted to get, but couched in righteousness, but the righteousness of Christ. So we could talk a lot about those things. So let's then begin our notes today, beginning with the purpose then for the Sermon on the Mount. Okay, so purpose. The Sermon on the Mount. What was the Lord's intention? We're going to look internally to see these things, and I'll write these major points. You could put those things underneath there. All right, so what is the purpose of the teaching on the Sermon on the Mount? Let's pray and then we'll get started. Father, thank you for your love for us. Lord, I ask you to bless us now this morning in our class as we have gathered now to look at your word. Thank you for yesterday, and thank you for the teaching and the preaching in 1 John 5, this idea of keeping ourselves from idols. What a very succinct and distinct phrase, and yet full of meaning, and it really is very, very current for us. And we think of an idol as something that we've fashioned with our hands. But the truth is that it could be anything that leads us in a false way. And so thank you for that understanding. Thank you, Lord, for the person that was saved and baptized, for Stormy. What a great encouragement that is. And the things that you're doing in our church, we're grateful for it. And I pray that all of us would see and understand that although it doesn't seem like you're working, you are. And if we'll just stay with it, we'll just keep staying right with you, and we'll keep plugging along, You'll bless us with people, you'll bless us with people to minister to, and you'll be good to us that way. So help us now to understand the scriptures and understand what you've given to people in this sermon so many, many years ago that is applicable for us today. And so, Lord, thank you. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so one of the purposes is to establish the understanding of the law. All right, so one of the things the Lord wanted to do, I guess maybe the purpose is to give understanding of the law. Okay, so if, and the Lord speaks much about the law and about righteousness and about what the requirements are, and he says in verse 20 of chapter 5 that unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the Pharisees, and there's a lot that is, I believe it's verse 20. Yeah. Then there's a lot that is said there. So what is the righteousness of the Pharisees? Well, that is a righteousness according to the law, right? And so what the Lord says there is that you have to exceed that righteousness. You have to be more righteous. So it's impossible for man to be righteous according to the law. Therefore, we conclude that that's not the purpose of the law. Hopefully, by this time, you understand that the law wasn't established as a way of salvation, but rather it had a different purpose. And so the Lord wanted to very clearly explain here the purpose of the law. And so that was one of the reasons or the purposes for the Sermon on the Mount. And this would be applicable to following the contextual setting in chapter 17 of verse 4, because he says, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." This idea of repentance, then, is not obedience to the law, right? It is something else. And so repentance and acceptance of Christ allows somebody to have entrance into God's promises, the kingdom of heaven. All right, so we have to understand, then, what purpose the law has for us even today. What is that purpose? And he goes on to explain that. Let's look at verses 17 through 19. "Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, One jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law until all be fulfilled. Whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments and shall teach men so, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven, but whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. There is a teaching out there in churches that we are no longer under the law but under grace. In other words, the idea is that we forsake the law completely, and the law really has no purpose in the life of a Christian today because we're under grace. That, according to these verses, is absolutely not true. All right, so then we have to establish the purpose of the law. If it is not to provide a way of salvation, but if that is through grace and repentance and God's gift to us, then what purpose does the law fulfill? Well, the first thing is it prepares the way for the gospel. I think that you understand that, hopefully, that without the law, the heart is not prepared for the way of the gospel. And so we need to have a standard, okay? A standard of righteousness from that is apart from us, that we can see how short we fall. I always like to use the example of a speed limit sign. So if the policeman were to stop you and say to you, or you might ask him, well, why did you stop me? And he would say, because you were going too fast. And you might ask, but what is the limit here? Well, what if at that point he were to say, there is no limit, I just feel very deeply that you were going too fast? Well, but what's the speed limit? How am I going to know there is no speed limit? I just feel like you were going too fast. Well, how am I? I'm going to get a zillion tickets, right? That doesn't seem fair, does it? Right? You wouldn't know. You wouldn't know. There'd be no way for you to know if you're going too fast or not. On the other hand, if he took you over to the sign and he said, this said speed limit 30, you were going 80. Undoubtedly the case, lead foot. So the speed limit is 30. Then you look at 30 and you look at your speedometer and you say to yourself, okay, I do quick math. Oh, going 50 miles an hour over the speed limit. That's more than twice. I'm in trouble. Okay. What can you say then? Okay. So, well, you can say something to the effect of, well, I just got the heads change in my engine. I'm blowing out some of the carbon. So I wanted to make sure that I had it up to speed. See, right? And you need to do that. It's very important. Otherwise, your idle position sensor isn't going to work right with all that carbon in there. I mean, it's pretty obvious. You got to blow all that stuff out. Everybody knows that. So the speed limit sign helps us to understand we need the law to help us to understand that. If we didn't have God's law, how would man ever know that they're a sinner? You might say, well, because they feel bad. That doesn't work, does it? The conscience does work to a point, but we can sear our conscience and give excuses. The Bible teaches that the way of man is right in his own eyes, right? In his own eyes, it's right. Everything I do is right. Everything you do is wrong. Everything I do is right, right? This is how it works. This is by nature how we are. So that's why we need something apart from us that will reveal to us who we are. And so that's what the law is for. Romans chapter 3, verses 19 through 22 says this, now we know that what things soever the law saith, it saith to them who are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped, and that all the world may become guilty before God. In other words, no excuses. The mouth may be stopped. Therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight, for by the law is the knowledge of sin. He doesn't say by the law is the salvation from sin, but the knowledge of it. But now the righteousness of God without the law is manifested, being witnessed by the law and prophets, even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ unto all and upon all them that believe, for there is no difference. Okay, doesn't matter if somebody is a memorizer of the law and somebody has no idea what the law is. They're both sinners, aren't they? And so there is no difference. Okay, so sin then is revealed to us through the law. And what's the problem with the Pharisees, though? Although they knew the law, they didn't consider themselves as sinners. They considered themselves as obedient to the law and certainly above everybody else. So the law then misunderstood the purpose of the law. In Galatians chapter 3, verses 10 through 13, and then 24 and 25, you can just write those down. But there are a lot of things here that are very, very good. It's very good teaching for those people that believe that righteousness is by the law. If you talk to enough people, and you might knock on doors, and you might ask to them, are you a sinner? Yes or no? Well, how do we know? How do you know that you're a sinner? Well, because, and then it may, if they know something about the scriptures, go to the Ten Commandments, right? That's the summary of the law. And you say, well, and then you might say to them, so what are the Ten Commandments? They don't even know what the speed limit sign is. They have no idea. Well, how can you know whether you've done right or not if you don't even know what they are? And that is your own standard? All right, so here we go. So then I always take them to Galatians chapter 3. If they believe that their works save them, And it says, therefore, as many as are of the works of the law are under the curse. So who are the people that are of the works of the law? The people that believe the law, that being a good person saves them. Those people are under the curse. And I like to stop there and say, now here it says that the people that are of the works of the law are cursed. According to what you said, you think that of the people that are of the works of the law, this is the standard of righteousness, but the Bible says you're cursed. How is that? Why? Right? So then I ask myself, well, why? You might ask yourself, why? Well, the next phrase tells us, for it is written, cursed is everyone that continueth not in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. Why is somebody who is of the law cursed? Why? What does it say right there? What's the standard? Cursed is, let me accentuate some words to help you. Oh, yes, Jacob.
They have to do all
of it. Everything, continually. Yeah, exactly. So what is the standard? It is the law, yes, but it is absolute and complete and total perfect obedience of law, continually with absolutely no mistake whatsoever. Right? So have you fallen, you might ask the person, have you fallen short of that? Well, you know, here we go. So the standard really is, if you're going to be of the law, then the standard is absolute perfection with no mistake at all. I suppose that if there's somebody that has fulfilled the law completely and has never made a mistake ever one time in their entire life, they could go to heaven, couldn't they? They could. The problem is that that person doesn't exist. Because the Bible also tells us that all of us have sinned. So, and then there are some people that actually would tell you yes. And if you ask them, well, have you done everything perfectly? They might say yes. Then after your after you get back up, and then the next question would be, okay, well, how do you know that? Well, the Ten Commandments, right? And they don't even know what they are. How can you say that? Well, it goes on then to explain some more things. Then it says, but that no man is justified by the law in the sight of God, it is evident. Okay, so in God's eyes, no man is justified by the law. That is evident. It's obvious. Why? Because the Bible says the just shall live by faith. Now, there's something else. You got the law, and then you have faith. Wait a minute. What is faith? People might say, well, accepting Christ's sacrifice, yes, but I also have to do something, right? It's one thing. This passage makes a very clear distinction between faith in Christ and obedience to the law, that they are not at all the same. Look what it says. And the law is not of faith. What does that mean? That obedience, if you are of the law, then you have no faith. On the other hand, if you put your faith in Christ, you must abandon that you were of the law. You cannot have both. It's impossible. But the man that doeth them shall live in them. In other words, if you're going to abide by this idea of being of the law, then you'll have to also suffer the punishment when you don't do those things because you're under the law. But who put them under the law? Anybody that would believe that way, who put them underneath the law? Who put the Pharisees underneath the law? Did God put them under the law? No. Who put them under the law?
Themselves.
Exactly. They put themselves there. They also had the sacrifice of the temple to see, to help them to see that. So they chose the law over the temple sacrifice, or the symbolism of it. And then verse 13, I love this verse. So we have faith, and we have obedience to the law. They're not the same thing. But then the question might be asked, well, put my faith in what? In my church? In my pastor, my whatever? My parents? I'm from a Christian family. That's what I'm going to put my faith in. Is that what it is? Verse 13, Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law. Our faith is in Christ. I love that verse. He hath redeemed us, because it's past tense. It's a done deal. He's redeemed us from the curse of the law. How? Being made a curse for us. So God doesn't go back on his holiness just because we're sinners. He doesn't accept us by forsaking who he is. How then can a holy God accept us who are completely unholy? Christ is the absolutely and completely the only answer, the only way that can possibly happen. There is no other way, even by logic. For it is written, curses everyone that hangeth on a tree. So then the question is, wherefore the law was our schoolmaster to bring us to Christ? We see that purpose right there. That we may be justified by faith, but after that faith has come, we are no longer under a schoolmaster. So the Lord then, in the Sermon on the Mount, and we have this backed by Paul's writings, was to prepare the way for the gospel. So that's one of the purposes of the law. Secondly, is to give the requirements of the law. In verse 48 of chapter 5, It says, be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father, which is in heaven, is perfect. Again, this is a reiteration of what we talked about before, that it requires perfection. So the Lord helps them to understand that the understanding of the law is not only that the law is a schoolmaster, it prepares the way for the gospel, it also gives the requirements of the law. And that requirement is absolute and total perfection. Okay? So the law is a shadow of God's perfection. It is not the way of perfection. It's a shadow of it. The Bible teaches that. And then, so we understand the law more when we understand that it prepares the way for the gospel, that it gives the requirements of the law. And then it is a summary of the, and then the Sermon on the Mount also gives a summary of the requirements of the law. And that summary is found in verse 12 of chapter 7. There it says, therefore all things whatsoever ye would that men should do to you, do ye even so to them. For this is the law and the prophets. So he's indicating that that's all of what God has written. It's contained in that one phrase. We might say, do unto others you would have them do unto you. By the way, the Lord raised that bar of the standard. So here it says in Matthew 7:12, do unto others as you would have them do unto you, right? But then Jesus also took it a step further, and what did he say? Do unto others as I have done unto you. That takes it a step further, doesn't it? Okay. So I, because you might not mind some things, and you say, well, I wouldn't mind if they did it to me, someone did it though. I can take it, they should take it too. But then Jesus says, well, but do unto others as I have done to you. I've done these things for you. I've loved you in this way. We should love others in that. Well, that's a very high standard. Okay? Does it exceed what the law teaches? Well, that does. You see, the Lord moved that bar of righteousness, standard of righteousness, even further in the more righteous direction, if you will. So the fact that he made things, when he reflected more of the perfection of God to us beyond the law, tells us that the law can't be the standard. Because the Lord is the standard, who is God's word. All right, so then, and then keeping the law of the idea, the understanding of the law is the manner in which it is kept. Okay, so he gives us this understanding. In chapter 5, verses 21 and 22, you'll see what I mean in a minute. For where your treasure is, there will your, what does it say? Heart be also. The light of the body is the eye. If therefore thine eye be single, so you're a cyclops, thy whole body shall be full of light. Right? If you're a cyclops. No, it's not saying that, of course. But the idea is that it's a matter of the heart. So if we can understand that obedience to law is not a matter of do this and don't do this, it's not this rigid thing. When we looked at the parable of the Good Samaritan before, we kind of saw that. The Levitical priest, or the Levite, excuse me, and the priest considered the exact obedience to the law their standard, and therefore they found it within themselves to just leave this man to die, no problem, because the law didn't say exactly what to do. The law didn't say, listen, if there's a Samaritan beat up here in this exact place, then you need to help him. So because it doesn't say that, do you see how man can use the law for unrighteousness? They wanted to. But when it's a matter of the heart, then that is the true meaning of it. It's a heart matters. It's and Jesus helps us to see these things. Okay, when he says that, when he really gives what the idea of murder is, what does he say? If you hate somebody in your heart, you've already murdered them. So you see what he's saying there. So as long as I don't actually physically harm them or cause their body to cease functioning through my actions, then I haven't murdered them. Well, that's not true. When it's a matter of the heart, it's actually, you know, finding somebody repugnant or whatever, hating them, finding them repulsive. The very presence is disgusting to you. You say, I would never do that. No, let's not be so holy. Your roommate. Anyway, so we have hating someone. Be careful. Remember, as much as you don't like what your roommate does, they don't like what... Yeah, well, that's hard to take, isn't it? But it's true. It is the truth. You're just as much of a burden to them. Using the word fool, or raka, in Hebrew, what does Jesus say? That is, it involves intentionally hurting someone without a cause. So, The law said, don't call anybody a fool. Well, the intention there wasn't not to use the word fool. Jesus himself used that word. But it, rather it is, don't do anything to intentionally hurt somebody without a cause. Adultery, this idea of simply lusting, okay? So he raised the bar. He took it a step further. It is not just this, it is this. So he gives us the true perfection of the Lord. And so because it is not, what is ultimately teaching? That keeping the law is a matter of the heart. Okay, so the one thing that we see, the purpose of the Sermon on the Mount is to give us an understanding of the law. Secondly, is to give principles to live by. Okay, so we'll put give principles for the church age. And beyond, I guess, but anyway, give principles to live by. This is very practical. There are four, there are more, but I've just kind of summarized it using four things, in four ways here. Number one, prayer. So let's list them, and then we'll go back and give the verse for them. So one principle, to live by, is the principle of prayer. Secondly, is the principle of fasting. All right, so you have to always sprint and make sure that you're getting faster every day. Your walk from the dorm to your classroom, you got to shave a second off. Number three, laying up treasures in heaven. All right, laying up treasures in heaven. And then fourthly, putting God first, putting him number one. Now, this isn't a law thing. The very essence of these points are matters of the heart. Okay, so let's think about this. This is very practical for the table. So this is not just notes, okay? Is prayer a matter of the heart? Okay, let me give you the verse first. Matthew 6, 5 through 15, he just goes on to say, so those passages deal with prayer. And when thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets. They have the reward. When you pray, go into your closet. And then he gives us the manner in which we are to pray, praise to God and so forth. So prayer then, is it a matter of the heart? Or can it just be something that you do and don't do? Could you pray in such a way where it's kind of like, check, done, there we go. I got to do this, 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 and this. All right, so you got your to-do list, right? Pray, okay, there we go. Is that what it is? Is that what it's supposed to be? So then prayer, is it a matter of the heart? Yes. This is the principle lived by in the church age. So it's important to see that. What did the Pharisees have? They had the kind of prayer that deals with the way that they look. So they wanted people to know they were praying, right? And so they would, if you've ever seen somebody fast and, oh, no, thank you, I'm fasting. Oh, I see. I can remember one guy, my wife tells me when she was in college that there was somebody that in the breakfast, it used to be where the Jolly's room is now. And so there would be somebody sitting there reading his Bible in the morning. And so somebody came up to him and asked him, why are you reading your Bible? And he was waiting for it. He said, spiritual food before physical food. Okay, why don't you do that in the dorm? What in the world? So he was doing this to be seen of people, right? Pretty obvious by the answer there. This is not the idea of prayer. Prayer should be a matter of the heart. And so it should be something that we fall back on, just maybe even inside yourself. Maybe before you come to the door, Lord, help me. You see somebody walking by and they look like they're having a rough day. Maybe go up to them, say something, but pray for them, right? This is when it becomes a matter of the heart. You're walking with the Lord and just making it an idea of prayer. And that's when prayer is real. And that's when prayer isn't a chore. That's when prayer is a joy, because you're actually having a relationship with God. Do you realize that when you pray to God, you are reinstating what Adam was doing with God in the cool of the day, walking with him? Just think of it that way. Was it a chore for Adam to walk with the Lord every day? Was it something that he had to do? Was it his checklist there, walk with the Lord? I'm sure that he enjoyed that. I'm sure that the fellowship was very good. And when you pray like that, you have that exact same fellowship again. Fasting. Well, I think we can do the same thing there. Fasting is a matter of the heart. Sometimes the Lord leads in that. I don't know that I understand it completely, but I know that there are times where I didn't have... Now, there's the health fast. Sometimes you'll do it for health reasons. Okay, that's not the kind of fasting we're talking about, and that's fine. But the fasting we're talking about isn't something that you have to make yourself do. It's kind of like a natural thing. There are just some events that happen where you don't want to eat. You just have to spend time in prayer because you're extremely burdened in your heart. There have been times like that. There's not been many times, thank the Lord. But there have been times like that where it wasn't, I didn't have to make myself not eat. It wasn't even part of what I was going to do that day because I had other things more important. So I think this is when fasting is a matter of the heart. All right, laying up treasures in heaven. Matthew 6, 19 through 21. Lay not up for you. No, this is the Sermon on the Mount, right? Lay not up yourselves treasures upon the earth where moth and rust doth corrupt. I said dust, didn't I? How did I get that? Oh, rust doth. I came up with dust. Where moth and rust doth corrupt and where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures up in heaven where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt. And where thieves do not break through nor steal. For where your heart is, there will your... Where your treasure... Wow, I'm dyslexic this morning. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. So placing your treasure in the right place is a matter of the heart. It's not something that you have to do. It's not something that somebody makes you do. You certainly don't do it out of regret. All right, you lay up treasure in heaven. And then putting God first. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And all these things will be added to you, Matthew 6:33. Put God first. That's definitely a matter of the heart, right? So this is the idea, is to give principles to live by in the church age. A third thing that the Sermon on the Mount is, the purpose for the Sermon on the Mount, is to give a framework to... prove repentance. You might want to word it in different ways. I don't know what this invokes, but what I mean that is that give evidences that you have repented. Kind of a framework to show, okay, if you really repented, this is what's going to happen. Okay, you may have a better way to word that, but this is the idea. In Matthew, there again, this idea of repentance. We've gone through those verses already, but Matthew 4:17, repent for the kingdom of God heaven, right, is at hand. Okay, so this idea of repentance. So these Beatitudes, we call them in Matthew chapter 5, this is not, it doesn't teach a way of salvation, but it shows rather the fruit of salvation. And we get that from our context. So if our context is right, then this is the king telling his future subjects how they are to behave. And he's giving them some principles to live by. And so if it isn't, he's not teaching that the law is the way of salvation. In fact, he's teaching exactly the opposite. But what the Beatitudes do give us is evidence of having truly repented. See? So, for example, we'll give a few things. Hungering and thirsting after righteousness. Now tell me, would that be an evidence of true repentance? Before somebody repented and accepted Christ, after they've repented and accepted Christ, there should be a hunger and thirst after righteousness, shouldn't they? If you have somebody that's, I don't know, a drunkard or whatever, I always go to the extreme, but just somebody that bickers, has a sour face all the time and all of this, and then they say, well, I've repented and accepted Christ, but nothing, there's no change to the hungering and thirsting after righteousness. They don't even really desire to come to church as they should. Now, some things happen. They're not in the habit of always coming like that. I'm not talking about that, but they simply have absolutely no desire. I've done that. I've led somebody supposedly to have accepted the Lord, and then there was no fruit at all. And so I come to the conclusion that, well, it's not that they didn't say what they were supposed to. The issue was repentance. That's what the issue was. So this is a fruit of salvation. Hungering and thirsting after righteousness. Of course, in Matthew 5:6, it says this. And then being pure in heart, Matthew 5:8. Excuse me. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. So being pure in heart, that's conditional upon salvation.
Because according to Jeremiah 17 and other places, man's heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. So after we get saved, we should have a change of heart. Not a change. That doesn't mean a change of intention, but literally the heart is different. It's clean. It's pure. You have pure intentions. You don't try to manipulate people and situations. You're pure in heart. Another, and this is just a few examples, peacemakers. Well, they find peace, right? You're going to try to be peaceful and live peacefully, okay? And that can only be contingent upon repentance. So these things, if they're in the heart of somebody, it isn't. They're indicators of true repentance. All right. And then fourthly, it was another purpose was to teach the principles. Of the kingdom of God. I say K of G. Not KFC, rather K of G. Sure you get that straight. Kingdom of God. Right. Economy of words. So Jesus preached the principles of the kingdom of God. There are the principles by which man will live when Christ establishes his kingdom. Now this would include nowadays because of course the Lord reigns in a believer's heart through the presence of God's Spirit. We talked about that also. Some of these things have never been on earth that he talks about and will be when his kingdom is established. When the Lord establishes his physical kingdom on earth, he's going to rule with a rod of iron. He's going to make sure that things are done according to the way that he wishes them to be done. Look at Matthew 5:21. There it says, ye have heard that it was said of them of old time, thou shalt not kill. All right, and whatsoever that shall kill, and whosoever shall kill, shall be in danger of the judgment. But I say unto you, whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause, shall be in danger of the judgment. Therefore, if you bring, so you see, it's a higher standard, and he's going to enforce that standard. Bring your gift to the altar. And there rememberest that thy brother hath aught against thee. Leave there thy gift before the altar and go thy way. First be reconciled to thy brother and then come and offer thy gift. All right. So he's going to make sure that the sacrifices to him are pure sacrifices and right. So this idea of paying your debts. Agree with thine adversary quickly whilst thou art in the way with him, lest at any time the adversary deliver thee to the judge and the judge deliver thee to the officer and thou be cast into prison. Verily I say unto thee, thou shalt by no means come out thence till thou hast paid the uttermost farthing, which I assume is a very small amount of money. So you're going to pay it all. So what's the idea here? He's taking it a step further. He's giving us principles here of the kingdom of God. And when he establishes his kingdom, these are the principles that he's going to rule with a rod of iron by. Okay, so this is the purpose then of the purpose of the Sermon on the Mount. Okay, now let's talk a little bit more about the any questions here. Any preguntas? Okay, so now we're going to do the Beatitudes. We call them the Beatitudes. You understand this is not a word that's. Maybe one of those fancy words that was developed for this. I don't know. All right, so these are principles. Principles of holy conduct. The Lord is saying this is the way you are to conduct yourself. And of course, this is contingent upon repentance and acceptance of Christ. So is this a framework for us to live by even today? And of course it is, because the kingdom then, or he rules in his kingdom, remember, and through the presence of God's Spirit in our heart. So, the principles then. All right, let's just go through them and explain them, and then give the reward. So, there's going to be a beatitude and then the reward. So, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay. All right, and these are all in the book of Matthew. Chapter 5, I meant, verses 1 through 12. So this is the way that we're to behave in being obedient to the king. And this is a heart matter. Okay, number one, poor. So you might want to put a table. You might want to tabulate these things if you want to. You don't have to. But you could put beatitude, results, okay, explanation, whatever. Okay, so the first thing is poor in spirit. This idea of poor actually means to cower or cringe. Almost like a beggar almost. In fact, it's translated in the Bible as beggar. And the poor in spirit indicates that it is a spiritual condition. To be poor in spirit, then, what does that mean? It means to recognize your poor spiritual condition, to recognize that you have need of the Lord's help day by day, recognizing that we are spiritually weak without the Lord. This is the idea of being poor in spirit. What is the reward? Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Okay, so this recognizing your spiritual need is contingent upon salvation, right? And you're saved. You repent, realize that we need the Lord, and we accept Him. We're saved, right? Then entrance into the kingdom of heaven. So this idea of poor in spirit goes beyond salvation. It is included in our life, but this idea of our neediness spiritually of the Lord. Okay, number two, blessed are they that mourn. By the way, I think that poor in spirit is by design first, because there again, this deals with salvation and repentance. Then blessed are they that mourn. So the second beatitude is the idea of mourning. What does it mean to mourn? Well, I think you know, lament, wail, be sad, be sorrowful. It reflects the remorse over conditions that we see, maybe your own condition, maybe conditions in the world, whatever it might be. This expression of sorrow, always looking for God's mercy, always looking for His forgiveness. All right, so having an attitude of mourning, this idea, I think it would also include being sober-minded, being serious, but not accepting these things, always desiring, and this compassion would be included here. But again, it's a heartfelt thing, this idea of mourning. What's the reward? You will be comforted. Okay? Wonderful. So God promises comfort. And that's why the Holy Spirit is called, at least in part, the Comforter. All right, then thirdly, blessed are the meek. What does meekness mean? I think it has the idea of lowness, patience, very much like poor in spirit. However, this goes maybe a bit further, because it deals with obedience. It deals with patience. It deals with deferring to others. It deals with esteeming others higher than yourself. This is the idea of meekness, okay? Not thinking that you know more than other people and realizing that everybody can teach you things. That's just something I realize, is that everybody can teach me things. A child can teach me things. All of you have experiences that I don't have. All of you do. You've been to places I haven't been to. So all of you can teach me something. And that is true. Now, it is true I am the teacher in this class, but that doesn't mean that you can't teach me things also. And so when we talk and that sort of thing, I like to talk about interesting things, you know, things that are interesting, because I like to learn from people. I probably should do it more, but this is the idea of being meek, being teachable, having that sort of spirit where you defer to others. You see what I'm saying? You defer. When you interact with people, you don't try to take the high position, but you defer to them. You get them to talk about themselves. This is the idea, okay? So this is the meek. So people that are meek, well, they're going to receive God's word better because they realize they don't know everything. They're going to restore the wound. A person that's meek will more likely restore somebody. What I'm saying is they'll realize that they are also capable of whatever somebody else has done. Some of this meek, because they defer. They realize, and that's why it says, ye that are spiritual, restore such an one. So in the Bible, this evidence of meekness has a lot to do with that. So a meek person will restore better. okay, as a church member, a meek church member will put himself or herself underneath the authority of a pastor. A wife will put herself underneath the authority of her husband. And so if they're meek, okay, learned will teach you deferring. This is the idea. And the Lord says that those people will inherit the earth. Okay? So the promises then will be for them. So meek. So all this is evidence of it. And then number four, hungering and thirsting after righteousness. I think that's obvious. That's pretty much straightforward. This earnest desire for righteousness, or to do what's right, to be godly. The reward is you'll be filled. So this idea of hungering and thirsting in a spiritual way, the Lord says you'll be filled. You will no longer hunger and thirst. Merciful. That's another beatitude. That is to have compassion to those who are unfortunate. Not to say to yourself, well, they deserved it. Well, bless God, they got what was coming to them. Not to be that kind of person, but rather to be merciful. Okay, to help those who are unfortunate. To realize that you could very well be in that same situation. And then it says that that person will receive mercy. So it will be reciprocated. So the reward of giving mercy is reception of mercy, reciprocation. All right, two more things. The pure in heart, okay? Sorry, there were three more things. The pure in heart, this is interesting. It says that they will see God. So to be pure in heart is to be renewed, to be purified by faith. David says, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. So this idea of having your heart cleansed, so this has the idea of confession, repentance, has the idea of, and this is the requirement. So to be pure in heart is that way. And then the Bible says that they will see God. It is, maybe call it revival if you want to, but it's an issue, it's a heart issue in the cleansing of the heart. Be pure of the heart, they will see God. And then the peacemakers. To desire and delight in peace, if possible, with all men, as it says in the book of Philippians. But you cannot have peace without the Prince of Peace. And we don't have peace forsaking righteousness. That is the philosophy out there, that peace is the number one thing. Well, it's not the number one thing. God's standard of holiness is number one. And if peace cannot be achieved through that, by adhering to righteousness, then we adhere to righteousness. They will be called the children of God. They will be known by their making peace, by the way that they react to situations. And then lastly, the beatitude is, you should feel yourself blessed when you are persecuted for righteousness' sake. That's a beatitude. That is obviously not natural. That is something spiritual. But the reward is that you will see the kingdom of heaven. So he says, blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. So you'll have great reward in heaven. That's why in the book of Acts we see this carried out. They were beaten literally for righteousness' sake, but there was great joy, the Bible says, for those things. All right. The next thing we're going to look at. Plenty of time. Is the law of God and the Son of God. Okay, so we're just going to compare a few things. Not very many, maybe. And I've already somewhat talked about this. I have talked about this. But the amplification that Christ gives to the law. So let's just go ahead and write those things. Remember I told you that he said murdering, and then, but he raised the bar and he said, if you hate somebody, this kind of thing. So we might want to tabulate these things also. And we're going to give in one column what the law said and how the Lord amplified that law. So he says, once again, to reiterate, he's come not to destroy the law. So when we talked about here, the understanding of the law, we talked about some of these things. But let's go ahead and put some of those things down, because I'd like you to be able to give some examples. Okay, so here's I have law of God versus the Son of God. We're contrasting, not versing as in enemies, but just contrast. Maybe contrast is a better way. With the person of the Lord. Okay, so we're just going to put what the law says here and how the Lord raised the bar there. Okay, so he says, and he literally says, the law says this, but I tell you this. So he says in verse 5:21, ye have heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not kill, and whosoever shall kill shall be in danger of the judgment. But I say to you, interesting. So that's why we say the law of God versus the Son of God, because he says, this law says this, but I say this. So he speaks authoritatively. So what's one of the things? Murder. kill. Thou shalt not kill. The law says that. That's pretty plain, pretty straightforward. That shouldn't probably need very much explanation, but he raised the bar. He says, whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause will be in danger of judgment. And without a cause, you just don't like that person. Okay, there's no reason, you just don't like them. Okay, no cause. Well, you should be able to get over that. That's what the Lord says. Okay, so that's one way where the law says this, but he says this. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Number two, this is what the law says. Jesus says that if you looketh after somebody, to lust after them, then in your heart you've committed this adultery. All right, so he raised the bar. He says, the law says this, but I say this. Number three. he says that the law says that whosoever shall put away his wife, let him give a writing of divorcement. Okay? So he said, the law says, if you want to get divorced, then sign, get the papers prepared. Okay? But Jesus says in verse 32, but I say to you, that whosoever shall put away his wife, saving for the cause of fornication, causeth her to commit adultery, to whosoever shall marry her that is divorced committeth adultery. Pretty clear there, isn't it? Pretty straightforward. Jesus says, well, the law said this. It was because of the hardness of their heart that Moses allowed them to do that. But Jesus says that if you put away your wife for any cause, except for fornication, okay? By the way, This does not allow people to be remarried. It just says that there may be grounds for divorce, okay, but not remarriage. In fact, he says that in that case, they would be committing adultery. So he raised the bar. Actually, he didn't raise the bar. He just went back to the original intention of creation, right? He said Adam and Eve were, and this was the original intention. This is what it should be. Things got muddled up, sin and all of that, but he jumps back to the original intention. So then, another thing is an eye. Let's just do this one. An eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. So if you take my tooth, I'm supposed to take yours. If you take my eyeball, I'm going to take yours. And if your eyes happen to be brown, then I'm going to have one brown eye and one blue. Like a husky. So, but the Lord said, resist not. So an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. In the law, it would justify those things. But Jesus said, resist not evil. Whosoever shall smite thee on the right cheek, turn him also the other. The idea here is the idea of being righteous. And that in any given situation, sometimes the best thing would be to react differently than what other people would. So that people will see that there's a difference. Okay? I guess one more we'll look at. The law says, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. 5:43. Well, what if your neighbor is your enemy? Anyway, let's move on. You have heard that it hath been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thine enemy. But the Lord says, love your enemies. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. Not in a way where you're a, you know, oh, woe is me, okay? But in truth, because of the Lord and in his strength, and you're doing it for him ultimately, not for yourself, in this way, raising the bar there. So you see, there are, the purpose of the Sermon on the Mount was to give the Lord's, to give a better view and a better picture of who Jesus is. He's the Son of God. He raised the bar. Okay, so we get a better picture of what he expects, a better picture of who he is, a better picture of what true righteousness is, what true heart godliness is, heartfelt godliness is, a true picture of God himself through the person of Christ. All right, let's look at rules for the redeemed. Okay, so now we got a set of five rules. And these overlap a little bit with these. All right, so we've got rules. Let's say rules of the redeemed. Aha. Now, what are some of these rules? Well, one of them is, I'm just going to give them some names. The first one is the money rule. It's a money rule. What's that? Lay up not for yourself treasures upon earth, where moth, here we go, where moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. Well, I suppose there's dust also, isn't there? Rust and dust and moth and rust. And they all corrupt. So there's the money rule. The idea is that is which has been given to you. Store up those things in heaven, okay? Not here on earth, because when you die, you're going to leave it all here. This is the idea. So this is a rule to live by. If you want rules to live by, there's one. Secondly, is the golden rule. Okay, we're just listing these things. It is a reiteration, but it's a golden rule. He says, do unto others as I have done unto you. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. This is a golden rule. Now, here's one that's a little bit different. The judgment rule. Now, this is a big one nowadays. Matthew 7:1, judge not that ye be not judged. It's funny how people stop there, don't they? What do? Judge not. And they stop right there. That's not what the verse says. The verse says, judge not, lest that ye be not judged. So in other words, don't judge in such a way where you haven't judged yourself first. That's the summary of it. All right. The idea of a judgment rule, or the rule here, because then it says, for with what judgment ye judge, so then if in verse 1 he's saying don't judge, in verse 2 he's saying judge. So is he contradicting himself? Obviously no. For with what judgment ye judge, ye shall be judged, and with what measure ye meet shall be measured to you again. Remember, if you're going to judge, that you're going to be judged by the same rule. So make sure that you're not doing it. All right. So if you're going to tell somebody they're prideful, for example, and you're a prideful person, how are they going to look at you? What about you? Right? And that is true. So don't judge in such a way where you don't first examine it in yourself. And if we do that, it's pretty much going to keep judgment to a minimum. That's the judgment rule. What the worry rule? Chapter 6, verse 31. Therefore take no thought, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or wherewithal shall we be clothed? For after all these things do the Gentiles seek, for your heavenly Father knoweth that ye have need of all these things. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. So this idea, it's a cure for anxiety. No need to be anxious about things. God is good. He loves us. And if he clothes the lilies of the valley, would he not clothe us? They don't worry about it, and so neither should we. This idea of not worrying about things, trusting the Lord. So a Christian who is a worrywart and concerned about things, overly concerned about things, is somebody that is exhibiting a lack of faith. And then the prayer rule, okay? Chapter 7, verse 7 and 8, ask and it shall be given unto you, seek and you shall find, knock and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that receiveth, and he that seeketh, findeth, and him that knocketh, it shall be opened. So whereas before we talked about prayer being the standard, something that you fall back on, the attitude of prayer, that's a heart matter, here is how prayer links with faith, okay? Trusting and believing that what you're praying is he's going to hear it and help you. All right, so that's rules for the redeemed. All right, let's look at sets of twos. I'm just going to look at two of them for lack of time. Okay, so he has sets of twos or duets, all right, for you musically inclined people. Let's put the, I'll just put duets, I don't know, sets of two. There are a lot of duets in the Sermon on the Mount. And you'll see what I mean. The first one we'll look at is salt and light. Right? He says in verse 13 of chapter 5, 13 and 14, ye are the salt of the earth. But if the salt have lost his savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is thenceforth good for nothing, but to be cast out and be trodden under the foot of men. Then he says, ye are the light of the world, the city that is hid on a hill. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid, neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men. So he's two things here, or salt and light, right? So the salt, this idea, is when does a Christian salt, if you will, lose its savor? When does that happen? When are you no longer, he says you are the salt of the earth. So like it or not, we're salt. Now sometimes you may be a salt that is savorless, and therefore it's good to melt ice anyway and trodden upon the foot of men, right? But it's salt anyway. When does salt lose a savor? When are you no longer a flavorful salt?
When you cease functioning in your job, which is to tell others.
Okay. All right, that's true. Let's be more general.
I guess when you become rowdy.
Rowdy, did you say?
Worldly.
Oh, worldly. Yep, yep. So, right. So put it into what does testifying, you know, being apart from the world, what does all of that encompass? A Christian's what? Testimony. If you lose your testimony, you've lost your savor. There's nothing you can do. If in your workplace you don't have a good testimony of those around you, in truth, you're pretty much worthless at that workplace. Now, you may get your money, okay, but that's not the ultimate goal there. It is a goal. Okay, you need to make money. All right, but the point is that if you lost your testimony, you're pointless there. A pastor in an area that has lost his testimony, it's over. It's done. You might as well go somewhere else. When you get to the point where you realize your testimony is just as important as your salvation, it really is. It's your salt. You're salt. You are salt. So if you've lost a savor, so if you're somebody that's given over to anger and that sort of thing, you're going to have a bad testimony. If you're somebody that's known for being impulsive, it's a bad testimony, isn't it? If you're a glutton, whatever. This is a bad testimony. If you lose your testimony, you lose your savor. And then light. Okay? In the same way that the flavor of salt is lost, light is not shown. Right, so a Christian that has lost his testimony is somebody, it's like a light under a bushel. The light's there, has the capacity, but doesn't shine out. Just like the salt's there, has the capacity to flavor, preserve, and all that, but it doesn't do so. So a Christian that's lost his testimony is like light with a bushel over it. So as you see this duet, we also have two gates, right? A wide gate and a narrow gate, that's another one. Well, let's talk about two trees. And I'll have to stop here because I want to clear, and I chose this because I want to clear some things up. But in chapter 7, verse 15, here it says, beware of false prophets. So what is the Lord speaking about here on the Sermon on the Mount? He's talking about false prophets, which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves. Ye shall know them by their fruits. What is he talking about? When it says, "You shall by your fruits, you shall know them. You shall know them by their fruits." Who? Who's the them? In particular, who's he talking about here? False prophets, isn't he? So, you know, people like to quote that verse, "You shall know them by their fruits," and all that, saying that you'll know a Christian by what he does. But that's not what the Lord was talking about, was he? He's talking about false teachers in particular. That doesn't mean that the principle of true repentance of what it is in the life person isn't there. But this verse does not mean that. Here he's in particular talking about false teachers. So there are two kinds of trees, the fruitful tree, or a good tree, and then a bad tree. The good tree produces fruit, and this would be a good teacher. What is the fruit of a good teacher? Those people that are under him. Do they follow these things? Are they taught well? Are they educated well in the things of God? Are they following a good example? And then a bad tree is one that does not have fruit, and this is a type of a false teacher. It's only professing those things, but can't back it up with true godliness. So he contrasts two trees there. Two builders, the wise builder and the foolish builder. So anyway, we have a series of duets. You should be able to explain some of those things, the salt and light and the trees and all that. All right, we've wrapped up the Sermon on the Mount with verses 28 and 29. How did the crowd react to Jesus' Sermon on the Mount? It came to pass when Jesus had ended these sayings, the people were astonished at his doctrine, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. So it produced a manner of astonishment in these people because they're not used to this kind of teaching. They weren't used to this teaching on the law. They weren't used to this giving understanding of the law and principles as opposed to this stringent do this, don't do that. They weren't used to Beatitudes. They weren't used to being poor in spirit and having these right things. It's opposite of what they thought. The law of God says this thing, but I say this. The authority of Jesus' teachings, the rules of the redeemed, the content, and then these duets setting these things, it's kind of teaching that they were not accustomed to, especially in the synagogues. And it is the kind of teaching that today is becoming more and more scarce. So to teach what I've just taught today, to teach the understanding of the Sermon on the Mount, just to read it the way it is to somebody, if you were to read it to a worldly person, to a person that is driven by their desires and carnality and the things of the world, this kind of teaching is totally radically different. Undoubtedly, they'd be astonished. Can't expect me actually to abide by that. So this is the way they reacted to it. Okay, I'm going to go to my office right now and put this quiz on Schoology. You just take it and print it out and have it ready for next class time, which is Thursday? When is it? Thursday, yeah. You're dismissed.